A topic for paper presentation is imaging of intraosseous lesions of patella done at Sharda Institute of Medical Sciences. Aims and objectives are to correlate radiography MRI findings of intraosseous patellar lesions with histopathological diagnosis. All cases of tumors and tumor-like lesions of the patella diagnosed in the Department of Radiology at the Sharda Institute of Medical Sciences between May 2020 and September 2021 were included. A sample of 20 cases were reviewed under this study. This is a prospective analytical type of study. Results, there were 11 male and 9 female patients with age range of 20 to 72 years. The presenting symptom was majorly knee pain. The most common patellar intraosseous lesion in my study were benign tumors of 11 cases. The most common benign patellar intraosseous lesions in our case series was giant cell tumor in 7 cases. The second most common benign patellar intraosseous lesion in our series was chondroblastoma in 3 cases. One case of aneurysmal bone cyst was present. There was no malignant tumor in my case series, and there were 9 cases of non-neoplastic conditions, which includes 5 cases of dorsal defect of patella, 2 gout, and 2 tuberculosis, and 1 case of rheumatoid arthritis. Discussion: the patella is an uncommon location for tumors. It is involved in 1 to 4 out of 1,000 cases of bone tumors present with non-specific symptoms such as pain, swelling, reduced range of movement, mass or pathological fracture. Preoperative diagnosis is often difficult because radiographs only allow evaluation of aggressiveness and not the histological diagnosis. Imaging with the use of CT and MRI plays an important part in the diagnostic workup. Majority of the patellar tumors are benign. The vast majority are giant cell tumors and chondroblastomas. But some uncommon tumors and tumor-like conditions can cause diagnostic dilemmas. Giant cell tumor, it is the most common type of diagnostic patellar tumors, which includes 1/3 of the total patellar tumors. Plain radiographs demonstrates an osteolytic lesion with faded boundaries. CT findings include an intraosseous lytic lesion with cortical thinning or cortical erosion and joint diffusion. Pathological fracture may be present in few cases. On MRI, the lesion shows higher signal intensity compared to skeletal muscle on T1 weighted sequence and heterogeneous signal intensity on T2 weighted sequence. Contrast enhanced fat suppressed T1 weighted sequence demonstrate heterogeneous strong enhancement of the lesion. Total patellectomy is usually the preferred treatment for aggressive GCT of patella. Here we can see lateral knee radiograph showing osteolytic lesion, whereas similar findings are seen in the knee skyline view. On sagittal T1 weighted sequence, sagittal proton density fat sat and sagittal axial proton density fat sat sequences, so we can see heterogeneous mass in the upper pole of the patella involving the anterior and the posterior cortex with cortical thinning and sclerotic margins. Similar findings in cases of histopathology, we see tumor-like giant cell, which is characteristic of giant cell tumor. Chondroblastoma, it is the second most common benign patellar tumor. Plain radiographs demonstrate a radiolucent lesion with well-defined sclerotic margins. Pathological fracture may be present. MRI shows the lesion has low to intermediate signal intensity on T1 weighted sequence and intermediate to high signal intensity on T2 weighted sequence. Appearance of a lobulated lesion within an expanded patella with a low signal intensity rim. Fluid levels may occasionally be seen. Low signal intensity foci within the tumor corresponding to calcification seen on plain radiographs or CT can be seen. Bone marrow edema is present in majority of cases for which stitch sequence is of particular value. Here we can see lateral radiograph of the knee and the knee skyline view showing lytic lesion involving the patella with lobulated margins and thin out cortex. Here it is the sagittal proton density and axial proton density knee images showing heterogeneous expanded mass in the patella with endosteal scalloping and an hypo-intense rim. Tumor-like conditions, which includes gout, plain radiograph shows lobulated, well-defined, expansile osteolytic lesion with sclerotic rim. MRI shows bone marrow edema and well-defined expansive soft tissue lesion with low signal intensity on T1 weighted and high signal intensity on T2 weighted sequences. Thickening and heterogeneous signal intensity in the patellar tendon has been described. Here we can see lateral knee radiograph shows osteolytic lesion with sclerotic rim and soft tissue calcification. Here it is an axial proton density fat sat, axial proton density and sagittal proton density knee images showing destruction of the anterior cortex of the patella with heterogeneous signal intensity. Tuberculosis, the knee is the third most frequent location for tuberculosis. Knee tuberculosis mainly involves the synovium with local extension eroding the bone. Knee tuberculosis is rare. Usually, patellar tuberculosis are very rare in compared to knee. Brain radiographs may show lytic area with sclerotic borders. Sequestrum may be present as a density. MRI detects intraosseous lucency with central calcific density, suggesting chronic osteomyelitis with sequestrum, early bone marrow edema, and soft tissue abnormalities. Diagnosis is usually confirmed by histology and bacteriology. Here we can see lateral knee radiograph showing some osteolytic lesions, rim enhancement of the bone abscess with general enhancement of the edematous patella. In cases of sagittal T2 fat sat A imaging, we can see on when we aspirated the fluid from the knee joint and subjected to acid fast bacilli staining, we can see multiple acid fast bacilli. Rheumatoid arthritis, brain radiographs include soft tissue swelling, osteopenia, loss of joint space, erosion, growth disturbances, and joint subluxation. MRI shows synovial hypertrophy, joint effusion, as well as osseous and cartilaginous lesion. Active synovitis is characterized by enhancement on T1 weighted gadolinium contrast studies. Dorsal defect of patella, it is a characteristic lytic patellar lesion, which is a normal variant in case of ossification. It is usually an incidental radiographic finding, but occasionally may be symptomatic with knee pain. On plain radiograph, dorsal defect is round radiolucent lesion surrounded by a zone of sclerosis located on the superior lateral aspect of dorsal surface of the patella. MRI shows a hemispherical defect in the deep cortical surface of the patella with intact overlying cartilage that thickens to fill the defect. It demonstrates low signal intensity on T1 and high signal intensity on T2 weighted images. The location, the radiographic appearance, and the clinical course are unique, distinguishing it from other lesions of patella. It should not undergo biopsy, as it is a benign condition. Here we can see AP radiograph of the knee showing well-defined lucency in the superior lateral aspect of the patella, suggesting a dorsal defect of patella. Here it is a sagittal proton density and sagittal proton density fat sat images showing high signal intensity on fat separation sequence in the upper posterior aspect of patella with well-defined sclerotic margin and with the cartilage intact and filling in the lesion. Conclusion: MRI imaging features in conjunction with other radiographic features on plain radiographs or CT may help narrow the differential diagnosis for tumor and tumor-like lesions of patella. Imaging may obviate the need for tissue diagnosis in some cases. If there is suspicion of malignancy, histological diagnosis is always the gold standard and should be obtained before definitive treatment. These are my references. Thank you.